Denmark, Detroit, and FIFA are all on this day. Welcome back to On This Day. Today's date is June 11th. There are 203 days left in 2020, and it's the 24th week of the year. We're almost at that midway point. No real holidays today. There is one. It's a religious holiday. It's called the Feast of Corpus Christi. I know that sounds like a barbecue festival in Texas. It is not. The Feast of Corpus Christi commemorates the sacrament of the Holy Communion in the Roman Catholic Church. Yeah, I mean, I went to Catholic school my whole life, and well, until they kicked me out, and I don't know anything about this one, but it's a thing. All right, let's see what else we had on June 11th. 1748, Denmark adopts the Nordic cross flag, and in no time, the rest of those bandwagon Scandinavian countries start using it too in one way or another. 1805, a fire consumes a large portion of Detroit in what was then known as the Michigan Territory. The blaze is believed to have begun in or near a stable owned by John Harvey, a local banker. How bad does that suck? 200 years later, we still know who the dude is that accidentally started a fire that burned down half the city. While no official cause was determined, it was rumored that hot ashes from his pipe started the fire. So I don't know what he was smoking, but apparently got a little too into it, set fire to the town. One of the first buildings that caught fire was a nearby barn, and the flames spread quickly to other wooden structures. 1837, the Broad Street Riot occurs in Boston, fueled by ethnic tensions between Yankees and Irish. An estimated 800 people were involved in the actual fight, with at least 10,000 spectators egging them on. Now, this is beyond a fight when you've got 800 people involved. This must have been quite the scene. At some point, the Irish had decided to focus elsewhere, and they started raiding residents' homes and vandalizing them and beating up the occupants. As Boston was a large immigration city, the Yankees felt threatened by the influx of poor Irish immigrants since their jobs and wages were on the line. About 3 p.m., after the Yankee firemen had finished up at a pub, one drunkenly shoved an Irishman during a funeral procession on Shea Street. The Irishman fought back, which started the riot. Always a good time when the Irish are involved. When my family first moved to Los Angeles, they tried to live in Los Angeles, and they were basically told no, so they had to kind of go where it was farmland at the time, sort of, which was Torrance, California. Yeah, the English didn't like the Irish moving into Los Angeles at the time. 1892, the Limelight Department, one of the world's first film studios, is officially established in Melbourne, Australia. It produced religious programming for the Salvation Army. 1920, during the U.S. Republican National Convention in Chicago, the Republican Party leaders gather in a room at the Blackstone Hotel to figure out who was going to be their candidate for the U.S. presidential election. This led to the Associated Press to coin the political phrase, a smoke-filled room. It suggests a group of powerful, well-connected cigar-smoking men having a private meeting, making big boy decisions. 1937, the Great Purge. The Soviet Union leader Joseph Stalin executes 8 army leaders. They had secret trials where the senior army leaders were accused of anti-Soviet conspiracies and sentenced to death. The rough thing about being sentenced to death back then, you were executed the next day. No appeal, no nothing. It was argued that the cases were based on forged documentation. However, after the fall of the Soviet Union, researchers investigated the matter and found out that Stalin actually concocted the whole scheme so that he could get rid of the most famous and important Soviet generals in a believable manner. I guess they bought it. 1963, John F. Kennedy addresses Americans from the Oval Office, proposing the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which would revolutionize American society by guaranteeing equal access to public facilities, ending segregation in education, and guaranteeing federal protection for voting rights. The legislation was actually proposed in June. It had been opposed by filibuster in the Senate. After Kennedy was assassinated in November, President Lyndon B. Johnson pushed the bill forward. The U.S. House of Representatives passed the bill on February 10th, 1964, and we're still having problems today. Guess we'll never learn. I don't know. I hope someday. Anyway, moving on. 1971, the U.S. government forcibly removes the last holdouts of the Native American occupation of Alcatraz, ending a 19-month protest and control of the island. The Indians of all tribes, or IOAT, claim that under the Treaty of Fort Laramie, all retired and abandoned out-of-use federal land was to be returned to the Native Americans who once occupied it. Alcatraz Penitentiary had been closed since 1963, and the island had been declared surplus federal property in 1964. So a number of the Red Power activists felt that the island qualified for the American Indians to reclaim it. 2010, FIFA's World Cup kicks off in South Africa, and they had these noisemaker things through that whole thing. I tried to watch it. I had to start turning off the volume because all the people in the stands had these weird gazoo-type things. There was just this humming through the whole World Cup. It was horrible. 2018, Three World Center officially opens. Premiered on June 11th. Okay, this is a big day for movies. This is a great list. 1982, E.T. is released and the nation goes crazy, and Steven Spielberg went from the director of Jaws and Raiders of the Lost Ark to one of the greatest filmmakers of our time. 1986, Ferris Bueller's Day Off is released, directed by my personal favorite director, John Hughes. God, that guy made some good movies. 1993, Jurassic Park is released on June 11th, again with Spielberg. And in 2004, Napoleon Dynamite, probably one of the quirkiest movies I've ever seen. Born on June 11th, 1959, Hugh Laurie, English actor and screenwriter. If you don't know who he is, he was House. You know that pill-popping doctor from that TV series House? Yeah, that was him. 1969, Peter Dinklage, American actor and producer. He's best known as the dwarf on Game of Thrones. He was on Saturday Night Live probably a couple years back, and they did a thing with Naked and Afraid. He went to the woods with Leslie Jones, and that one's great. If you get a chance, watch that. Died on June 11th, 2012, Anne Rutherford, Canadian-American actress. She is best known for playing Polly Benedict during the 1930s and 40s in the Andy Hardy series, and as one of Scarlett O'Hara's sisters in the film Gone with the Wind. She died at the age of 94 due to heart problems. 1999, we lost to Forrester Kelly, American actor. He is best known for his role as Dr. McCoy on the original Star Trek. Alright, that's today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, leave me a comment, give the video a big thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed already, please feel free to if you like what we're doing here. Everybody have a great day. Be nice to each other.